offices both in eastern Wisconsin, northern Illinois, and the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. I work with two other soil scientists, Carolyn Petches and Natalie Irizarry. We're responsible to maintain and update approximately 45 counties and 11 million acres for soil survey information. What is MLRA? Basically, we're trying to basically design soil survey to ignore some of the political boundaries. We look at the geographical areas that have things in common, ignoring state and county boundaries. Instead of, you know, designing soil survey map units by, you know, just in a particular county, we do things across county lines now. And throughout the country, we've designed these areas based on different cropping systems, different climate systems, land uses. So the good news is the availability of our soil survey data is almost nationwide, with some of the exceptions of the National Parks out west, some of the national monuments, but the Midwest is in really good shape. A lot of available soil survey information. The bad news is, when you look at the dates of these soil surveys, some of them are very old. The red being out of date, yellow being, you know, 30, 45 years old, the green being what we used to call up to date. Now, what does that really mean? To me, it just means different vintages of soil survey information. So, if I was going to compare concepts across county lines, they may not match. Because years ago, project leaders like myself, you know, before email and fax machines and everything else, one of the highest piece of technology in our offices were mimeograph machines. And we'd have to mail notes back and forth. A lot of these counties were mapped as little kingdoms. And I don't want to recognize this concept that Joe's recognizing over in Winnebago County, because this is my county. So a lot of times, and not necessarily through pride, but just through technology transfer issues, we didn't always recognize concepts across county lines. And you can see here, a lot of our counties in eastern Wisconsin were basically correlated in the 70s and the 80s and the 60s. And that actually means the field work was probably done a decade prior to that. We have what's been called soil data joiner correlation process that helps us combine map units across county lines. Because even though with the old published soil survey information here, concepts may have agreed across county lines, but sometimes they weren't populated into our database to agree across the county lines. So we're doing that at this point. So we have what we call a central concept. So maybe we have Kewaunee soil mapped in several counties. And if we interpreted the counties individually, they might be slightly different. And that causes problems across county lines. So we're identifying map units that we can combine. And now we're not combining all map units across county lines because some of them should not be combined. Just as an example here, Adrian, one of our monkey soils, is widespread mapped throughout our area. And we've got the concentration of Adrian in the eastern part of the state, and also up in Marquette, Waushara, Green Lake, and Columbia County. These Adrians didn't have much to do in common with the Adrians up there, so we basically made two different data map units, two different data piles in NRCS for those map units. So what that does is, the other major emphasis from soil data joiner correlation is the population of minor components. One of the things that happened during the phase where we transferred information from the hard copies to the digital copies, the web soil survey, was we left out a lot of the minor component information. So even though your map unit might have predominantly this major component in it, we did not recognize in the database the wet spots, the shallow spots, the inclusions. And why didn't we do that? Because there was nobody here to enter that information accurately. It was put on the people from other parts of the state in a very rapid fashion about 15 years ago. So, just as an example too, some of these map units over here that have not gone through the soil data joiner correlation process, the red ones, the yellow ones have, so the system map unit you're going to see is 100% system. And we all know in the real world that just isn't true. The trusset map units, we have broken down from 85% trusset, 10% Hockheim, 5% Lamartine. So those things are a slightly better real world picture. Other examples in the database, you might have this Teresa, which has not gone through our correlation process yet, is just mentioned as 85% Lamartine, or Teresa, but there's no minor components mentioned. That's where the database is kind of falling behind our knowledge. And this process that we're going through is basically combing all the data that we have, all the web soil survey, all the soil benchmark information, and bringing it up to a consistent level of accuracy. In a web soil survey now, you can call up a legend, and you can find your component percentages here. This Adrian map unit's marked as 100% Adrian. Again, that isn't true. We know there's inclusions of other components there. The real benefit to this process is these discrepancies across county lines are going to disappear. So you can see boundaries like this in the field, and they're definitely political. When they create a map that talks about, you know, depth of bedrock, or maybe a forestry application, or an agronomic application, and we see lines like this where interpretations change that fast, we know that's a remnant in the database that's incorrect. Same thing up in here. So we have some null values, some things where our database has to be caught up. So, long story short, by the end of 2017, we've gone through this process with about half of our land. So about 6 billion acres have gone through our soil data joiner correlation. And that's really good news. But the bad news is half of the past. And as we're combing through this data, we're creating inconsistencies in the database. We're making the database better and more accurately reflect some of the old information. But we're creating inconsistencies while we make things better. As we've gone through the database, we find a lot of issues that just are plain incorrect. And we're documenting those. Some of those things might be a lot of our components are mentioned with dual drainage classes. A lot of our soils are mapped, you know, well-drained / moderately well-drained. Paramaterial issues that will impact hydrologic soils group or can interpretations. Component restrictions are inconsistently applied. Slope group inconsistencies, surface texture inconsistencies. And it's like maybe Fond du Lac maps colliding with the silt loam surface, maybe Calman maps it with the loam surface. So we've identified several hundred of these problems, but we don't have a staff that large to maintain and correct these things. So we put these on the table and ask our users, our information, to prioritize these for us. So just a glimpse at 2017, we did 36 soil data joiner correlation projects, which, as an example, would be a soil map unit across this entire range. Implementation of 5 MLRA special projects, so some of these inconsistencies we talked about. And we do some long range studies with soil moisture, soil temperature, and that kind of stuff. Again, while improving our data throughout the MLRA, we've changed a lot of data elements. We're changing restrictive layers, we're populating water tables. So some in our database, some of our wet soils didn't even have water table populated. So all of a sudden, if you've got some land where you're wondering, well, how come I'm seeing water restrictions now? It isn't something that we've invented. It's something that we're only getting into the database from these public soil surveys. We have water capacity, saturated hydraulic connectivity changes, and population of forest fragments and rocks. So our whole purpose of soil survey is to find areas that are representative of larger areas. So we'll go out and find soil profiles that are representative. We'll send them in for laboratory sampling. And we do that by either renting or owning excavators and or taking advantage of manure pits that are open that you guys are doing some investigations for new manure pits. Any holes in the ground, we'll even look at construction areas and areas of putting in subdivision basements. We've been doing a lot of work in the Kewanee Manwa soil series. We're working on some temperature studies, applying a temperature probes throughout the MLRA to try to identify them properly. We've got a lot of soils for manure across those regimes. A lot of these projects will be 3 to 5 years in length. We're also working on some water table studies. I think this is what's really going to impact our soil survey the most, is identifying correct water regimes. Some of our dual drainage classes are really confusing and not accurate. Some will be able to pull out and get a better representation for it. Some we probably won't be able to. But basically, the way these work is, well, we put in these piezometers, we measure the water table depth for 3 to 5 years, and some of those are measured by us, by sitting a ruler down in the piezometer, and other ones are measured by a data log we place in there. It takes time to do that. We're also looking at some field work where we identify and quantify available water capacity and particle size, and also saturated hydraulic conductivity, how fast the water will infiltrate through the soil surface into the soil horizons. The whole thing we're working on, these special projects and getting away from some of our soil data joint correlation projects, the whole idea is to get away from estimates that we have and our soil survey information. If I can provide you with solid laboratory data for your major components like Kewanee, Manawa, Poygan, Anago, some of these large, wide-ranging soils, that way we can really provide good data in the database, where it's not just, the silt loam, so it must have a hydraulic conductivity of X. We're trying to get away from that. One other thing I want to assure you of, too, is we don't have any ambition to make changes just for the sake of making changes. Our soil survey information here, I place a lot of respect on the field work that it took to make these things. These guys were on the ground for 5 years digging holes. I can't do that anymore across that wide of an area. Like I said, we've got 45 counties with 11 million acres. Any little bit I look at for soil information with these special projects had better be a wide-ranging concept, because if we take a look at 7 or 8 spots and call something totally different, that's not our ambition. Our ambition is to basically enforce this information, make it better, and make your lives easier and more accurate with good information. We are getting some help from technology. One of the things we've been able to play with is this 3D scanner. Helps us measure the volume and the surface area of soil clods. Gives us a very accurate bulk density measurement fast, where we can do that in a couple days versus sending it to a laboratory and taking a year. We also have done a little bit of work with our EM meter to provide us with some information as to what's going on below the surface, the ground. Just as an example too, the soil survey legends are full of these goofy miscellaneous area groups. Like we have a sandy miscellaneous area. It's mapped a lot along the beaches of Lake Michigan, a little bit in interior here, and also into the Marquette and Columbia counties. And obviously that isn't the same soil, even though it's merely sand, kind of. Yeah, but we're finding that we have beaches and we have forests that are meant the exact same thing. So that's an area where we can leave some of the sandy land groups, some of them alone, and provide interpretations for others. I mean, obviously this piece of real estate grows better, even if it's just box elder, grows better trees than the beaches do. There's more things going on. So we're all about providing more information.